Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
I'm going to be Brian Corey from Simon Fraser University talking about technology everywhere.
Kind of an appropriate thing to talk about after sensor networks, when they're everywhere. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our experiences that we've had with WestGrid, which is a grid computing consortium in Western Canada. And one of the interesting things I'll comment on just before I start, so I attended the WACE workshop a couple years ago, and it was very, very technology focused at that point in time. And this community, Advanced Collaborative Environments, I think historically has been very technology focused. So I had a bit of a thrust on kind of human-centered design and things like that. And I would say that if we had a theme for this workshop over the last 2 days, it's been about human-centered design. So, I mean, I think that's a really important thing that we really need to get to. But I think some of the points I've made have been made several times already today, or over the last couple of days. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of context. I'm going to go over this really quick because we probably, well, number one, we're a little bit behind schedule. Number two, I think we've talked about a lot of this already. I'm going to talk about WestGrid, tell you what it is, and then talk a little bit about kind of the technology deployment that we did, what we did right, and what I think we did wrong, what we hope to do better next time. So a little bit of context, just the research environment that we work in today. And again, this has been talked about a fair bit. A lot of it is very global in nature. It's complex, multidisciplinary problems that people are tackling. We need to work with peoples in other departments, other universities, other countries. Often these are large-scale worldwide projects. Again, we've heard about a lot of these, the Fusion project, the Atlas project, the NIST project. These are all distributed projects that often work with unique instruments that people need access to. Again, the data we work with is increasingly complex. Simulations are getting more complex and capable, high-resolution instruments. None of this stuff is a surprise. A little bit about computational communities. I've kind of split computational communities into kind of two domains. Judith and Eric talked about one of them, and that's what I call a community that's formed to meet a specific research goal, and that's the the Atlas project or the NIST project. There's a specific scientific goal in mind for those projects. They come together, bring together distributed scientists, often involving kind of unique devices that they need to work around. And these evolve naturally over time, and that's probably the right way for a collaboratory to actually evolve. Then there's the other side of the coin that a lot of people are involved with, which is what I'm involved with, and kind of having the torque model that you guys have developed and asking some of the questions that you guys posed would have been really useful when we were kind of ramping up. You've got a collaboratory or a consortium of people that are coming together to provide a set of common infrastructure for a group of research scientists. And the main reason for doing this is to provide a range of resources that an individual institution couldn't supply, provides economies of scale, so you can have equipment that you have access to that you wouldn't have if you're just working with your individual institution. And that typically results in consortia like WestGrid, which is what I'm going to talk about in a minute, or TerraGrid and some of the data grid projects and things like that. Then there's the technology environment that we're, again, all familiar with. We've been talking a fair bit about today. We can do computations now that we, until recently, we couldn't do. And that's both on the scientific side as well as important on the collaborative environment side, that we can do image processing and things like that at a scale now where we couldn't do things. So we can do things like hand tracking and things like that that make interactive environments much more capable now than we couldn't do not too long ago. Ubiquitous displays. Displays aren't really ubiquitous yet, but we do find them all over the place. We find them on our mobile devices. We have a wide range of types of displays. We have high-resolution displays. We saw the tabletop, Lambda table talk this earlier today. We have 3D displays, and I said mobile displays. We've got sensors. The previous talk touched on a lot of this stuff. We can do 3D tracking, we have touch sensitive devices. The networking environment we work in is very, very capable. Is now we've got, again, wireless capability, so we have all these devices that can talk to each other. We have this optical networking, so we can do very, very capable things. We can send lots of information between between devices and environments. All this adds to the capability and the complexity of our environments. So I'm going to go on and talk a little bit more about WestGrid. In many ways, it's your typical grid computing consortium. There's nothing terribly special about it, really. It's basically covers the two westernmost provinces in Canada at the moment, although we are probably going back for another round of funding, so we'll probably be expanding that to the foremost westernmost provinces of Canada. And again, it has a set of computational, collaboration, visualization, data storage facilities that span the two provinces. It's connected together by a dedicated network. I'll talk about that in a second. So one of the things that we've done is we've created a set of advanced collaborative environment facilities at each of our sites across WestGrid. We base this on Access Grid Technologies. So we have one or more AG rooms at each of our facilities. And one of the interesting things about this is that we did not dictate a specific type of environment for our rooms. So people designed their rooms that met the needs of the local facilities and institutions. So that leaves us with a wide range of scales and types of environments. So we have kind of your large-scale multi-user rooms, a typical type room that you might see in an Access Grid environment, which is the top one. We have what I call interactive rooms or smart rooms, in some ways modeled after the Stanford iRoom. It's this kind of the second one down. That's a room at Simon Fraser University where I'm from. We've got a couple plasmas on the wall. We've got a rear projected screen in the back corner, and we've got actually a plasma that's not being used in this picture mounted in the table. So we've got a tabletop device as well. And then finally, some of our groups have integrated visualization capabilities into their Access Grid rooms. So we have some rooms that have a passive stereo or active stereo display capability that's a fundamental part of the AG environment. We run our own venue server infrastructure, so we can manage our own collaboration infrastructure. And we run our own meeting rooms and multicast bridging and things like that. So we manage our own infrastructure so that we have a little bit more control over it, and we can do some of the things that we want to do a little bit easier. We've also got a visualization infrastructure that we've deployed. Again, it depends on the various visualization needs of the institutions. And it ranges from your kind of the full range of scale, some fully immersive VR rooms, low-cost passive stereo type of environments, auto stereoscopic displays. We also make use of, and this is a little bit unique, I think, in some ways. We have deployed a visualization server, which is a large-scale SGI visualization machine, and it sits out there on the network. And we use that to ship visualizations across to the desktops of our users. And we make use of the fast network that our infrastructure provides that allows us to do that. And that gives us some interesting capabilities in terms of providing collaborative visualization as part of our environment. And we've done some work in integrating on that into the AG. I'm not going to talk about that today. And we've also done some work on integrating computational simulation into our visualization and collaboration environment as well. Again, I'm not going to talk about that in any more detail, but if anybody has any questions, I can talk about that. Not sure how much this group knows about the Canadian networking world. Canada has a pretty good international research backbone network provided by Canary and CANET4. So all of our research institutions are very well connected. You can see that unlike in the US, it's a relatively simple topology. If you look at a network map of the US, it's kind of like this. It's this big mesh, and we've got a line across the southern part because nobody lives in the north. On top of that is the WestGrid infrastructure. So each of the WestGrid institutions is connected by Canary as part of the fundamental Canary network, but we also have a dedicated gigabit network connection that is dedicated for WestGrid use that connects each of our institutions as well. So we've got a parallel, two parallel gigabit connections basically that join all of our institutions. And if you're going from a WestGrid facility to a WestGrid facility, it goes over the WestGrid network, which is has less traffic than the kind of core research network. So we have a very nice research infrastructure. In addition to that, Canary has this program that they're developing called user-controlled light paths. And this allows you to basically, in the Canary network, you're able to switch on a gigabit light path between any two locations, assuming you have the permissions to do this, at a user level. So I, as a user, can go in and actually configure a light path between Vancouver and Halifax on the East Coast almost at the click of a button. And I can do that, and I can leave it up for a couple of hours, and then I can tear it down. And then somebody else might do the same thing. So you have this, again, capability to extend this networking that we have off the WestGrid core network to anywhere in Canada, and ultimately anywhere in the world. I'm doing some work with EVL for the iGrid conference in a couple weeks' time, called the Global Land Visualization Facility. And for that, again, we're looking at creating a visualization test bed that has kind of this light path capability, so we can connect facilities at various places in the country in the U.S. and ultimately in the world with this light path capability. So we've got some pretty sophisticated networking capability that we have access to, as well as all the technology. Which brings me to the technology everywhere part of the presentation. So we've got all this technology, and you got your average particle physicist. I'm going to pick on the particle physicist today. And they want to solve a problem, and in particular, they want to solve that collaboratively with some of their colleagues that are across the world. They have a computation and data storage problem. They're talking about some information. We provide them with an advanced collaborative environment for them to use. On top of that, we kind of throw in some interaction technologies that they're probably not familiar with, being able to write on the plasmas and things like that. And then we throw at them some simple networking. And they get a little confused. And they don't use the capabilities as much as we thought. And that's kind of the situation that we're in at the moment with WestGrid. Is we've built this infrastructure. We thought about what the users would need to some degree. We talked to various groups. We knew that they needed to collaborate. We knew what technologies they used. But what we've got is a set of technologies that's a little bit over their head, and they're just not using them very effectively. So, in some sense, we've thrown technology at the problem and hope that this works. And if you think of kind of the grid consortium way that grid consortiums work, you get bigger computers, you get faster networks, you get larger data storage. And for computation and data storage, kind of throwing technology at it in some sense works. You have a machine that uses 8 processors, or a scientist who uses 8 processors, and all of a sudden he's got 64 processors. Well, he just runs his job on 64 processors. He's happy and it works. It's very rare that you'd find a computational machine that isn't full of jobs that are running flat out. There's a question as to whether that's utilized very well. So you've gone from 8 to 64 processors. You've got an increase in performance of 8 times. Whether you actually get an 8 times speed up in the application is a question that often doesn't get answered. That effectiveness of use of the resources on a computational side, it just, you know, it doesn't get answered. If you look at throwing collaboration technology at a problem, you put a scientist in that position, and the effective utilization manifests itself as frustrated users who can't get their job done, right? Because the tools aren't supplying a solution to the problem. So it doesn't work that way, certainly. And there's a big problem in providing solutions for our users. We have a great environment for our advanced collaboration environments research, but we're not really solving the solutions for our scientific users. And the main reason, and this has been talked about a fair bit already, is that they're too complex and too capable, and the barrier is just too high for our users. And a lot of people have said that today. So again, I'm repeating a little bit about what people have already said today. So we were guilty of making some mistakes. And bottom line is, we really have to listen to our users more effectively. We have to understand their needs, understand what they're trying to accomplish. Some of the stuff that Eric talked about yesterday, when he was talking about building a room for a specific need that actually causes people to, you know, allows them to do what they want to do in that room effectively, is kind of where we need to go. I mean, we don't want to build rooms that are for specific purposes, but what we need to do is we need to understand the tasks that people are trying to perform. We need to understand what the needs are and how important those needs are relative to each other. And we have to figure out how to map those needs onto technologies. So what Eric did in what he was talking about is he did that research for his group of people. He understood what they required. He built the room around that, and he made it easy for them to use. And what we need to do is get to that point in terms of understanding what people are trying to do in their collaboration tasks more effectively. One of the things that I think we've seen here is that working with users and their needs is very, very difficult. And you need some sort of a user-centered design methodology that's going to help you with that. And I come from a background, I'm a computer scientist. I'm a nuts and bolts kind of guy. And about 2 years ago, I started working with a group at the National Research Council in Ottawa. And one of the things that we started to do, because we had a couple of HCI and psychologists that we were working with, we started to approach this from a human-centered perspective. And it's really changed the way I've looked at solving some of these problems, because we've been throwing technology at collaboration for a long time. And just what we've been talking about over the last couple of days here in this meeting shows that I think the community in general has kind of realized that we really need to understand the process and what people are trying to accomplish and what they really need to accomplish those tasks. So we really have to step back and ask ourselves a couple of questions. What are we trying to accomplish here? We need to do that at all levels. We need to, when you're establishing a computational community, a consortium like WestGrid, we really need to think in more detail than we did about what our communities are trying to accomplish, what their needs are. We need to try to meet those. But you also need to ask that question at the low level. When you're trying to design a tool for a specific task, you need to ask that question about exactly what we're trying to accomplish. We don't want to just write tools because we think there's a need. We need to understand what people are trying to accomplish in our environments. What the task is that's being performed, what are the user needs, talk to the users and watch the users. And your local HCI techno-savvy psychology person is really, really helpful here, which a lot of us don't have. And that's really is a barrier, I think, to really making some progress. Although, again, as I said, I'm quite amazed at the things that we've talked about over the last couple of days, because it is really, it seems to be a shift from what WACE was 2 years ago to what WACE is today as to what kind of the topics are in terms of human-centered design and HCI and things like that. And I think we talked about this, Judith talked about it, I think Ray talked about it, a couple of people have talked about putting our knowledge against a framework of some kind so we can actually get knowledge out of it over the long term. So, you know, when Eric looks at this community that he looked at and saying, this is the task, and he identified what all those people are doing and what their requirements were, if I try to make a room that does the same thing as what he's done, if I don't have his knowledge, if we can't capture his knowledge and provide that to the community, we're going to struggle. So one of the things that happened, I already talked a little bit about this. Over the last couple of years, we've kind of evolved a bit of an ad hoc human-centered design methodology. We didn't do it the right way. We built a bunch of technology, and then we started to watch people struggle with the technology, and then we designed some tools to help them solve some problems. But what we really need to do is we need to really observe the user communities, we need to talk to the users, we need to identify what they really need to do in advance. Try to design environments that meet those needs. If we can't do that, we need to design tools that do that. But most importantly, I think we need to apply that knowledge to a task-oriented framework of some kind. We've been trying to develop something like this. There are other groups that are doing this as well. But I think that's a critical point. This project is by no means me by myself. There's a lot of other people involved in various aspects of it. Todd Zimmerman at SFU and my Westgrid colleagues. The group from the NRC and the CRC in Ottawa. Peggy Story at UVic. Pierre Belangeri and his group and our funders, of course. And I'll stop there, I think, and open it for questions. Thank you. Nothing? Thank you.
Of course, I'm going to support you.
Yeah.
But some of the difficulty, I think, is stuff that Steve talked about, is you can watch people and you can map out what they're doing, and then a miracle happens, and you actually figure out what it is.
Right. Well, what we're doing, and I didn't talk about this, but one of the things that we're doing, so we're talking almost entirely about synchronous collaboration, so immediate kind of video conferencing, shared applications and things like that. And what we're trying to do is we've tried to build a framework in which you can say, identify a task like a shared presentation or a face-to-face meeting or and try to identify which tools are important for those tasks and which parameters are important for the settings for those to meet the needs of that collaboration. And have, by defining that, so I can go into a room and say, I'm doing this, and the tools will all configure themselves with the right parameter settings and things. So we're trying to get to a framework where we can do that kind of thing. And hopefully what we're trying to do with that is we're trying to get to a point where we can say, we can both refine that task framework as well as refine the parameter settings within that framework so that we can, you know, we base it on our knowledge of CSCW work and what people have done with video conferencing and things in the past. And that's a starting point. But what that does is that gives a naive user the ability to say, I'm going to do a shared presentation, and they click a button and the system kind of configures itself. And we've got a prototype that we've integrated into the AG toolkit that's available that is a first pass at this. And it seems to work fairly well. We can do things like if you're having a low bandwidth user in your collaboration, at the click of a button, everybody's software just reconfigures itself so that it scales the tools appropriately for the type of meeting. So if video is important, it scales video relative to the other tools so that you decrease the video quality kind of relative to the other tools as the meeting requires. So and that we've been using that a little bit actually just within Westgrid, and it actually has worked quite well. And it just takes the burden off the users that makes it so that the naive person can actually be a little bit more functional. So. Is that it? Okay.